Good morning, church. It is so good to be with you all this morning. I'm Esteban, and this is my wife, Amber Rodriguez. I know that we got the Northeast Marrieds in the house, right? Making some noise.
Are you here?
All right. And we have the campus ministry as well here, right? Yeah. Okay, okay. Texas State, UTSA.
And also the Yo Pro.
That's right. Okay, representing. Awesome, awesome. It's so good to be together again with you all here. I don't know what kind of week you all have had. I know Texas State is just coming off of spring break, so maybe they feel refreshed and awesome. UTSA, I know you had your spring break the week before. Maybe you didn't like the week after spring break because, you know, it's not spring break. But wherever you're at, if you're married, maybe it was just another week, but it was a rough week, or maybe you had a great week. Wherever you're at, this is the place to be on a Sunday morning with family, to praise God, to really just sing praises to Him, to hear His word. Let's make sure that as we get our service started, that we get our hearts in a place where we want to sing to God, we want to worship God, where when His word is opened up, we show its due reverence to it, and that we soften our hearts to really receive His word. Amen.
And if this is your first time, we just want to say welcome. You are our honored guest. We are so happy you're here this morning. You know, personally, I've been super encouraged by the amazing weather. This is a great time to live in South Texas, and it's certainly a great time to worship God this morning.
Amen. Well, we're going to go ahead and get started with a word of prayer, and then we will have a time of worship. Why don't we stand on our feet so we can be ready to praise, and we'll get our service started.
Father, good morning. We are so, so grateful that this is a day and a time allotted where we get to worship You. What an honor it is to come before You, our gracious and merciful God, and sing Your praises. Father, I pray that our hearts are focused, that our minds are resolute and really following You, being obedient to You. God, we love You, we trust You, and we pray that You are with us this morning.
Father, we just come before You, God, humbled at just how incredibly majestic, powerful, forgiving, merciful, graceful, loving, just how incredible You are, Father. I pray that we see that as we sing praises to You, God, that we don't forget about how glorious You are, Father. God, about how You want to work in our lives, God. You didn't just create us to just be here, Father. You created us to be close to You, to work for You, Father, and to just love You and to be loved by You, Father. I pray that we can really just draw close to You at this time, Father, that we can walk away from this service, Father, feeling regenerated, God, feeling renewed, feeling like we're ready to conquer whatever the week has to throw our way, Father. We love You so much. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right, before we get singing, how's everyone doing? All right, I'm going to need a little bit more energy from the YoPro. Here we go. How's everyone doing? There we go. I just want everybody, could you just stretch up wide? I know it's the morning. Come on, just everybody in the room, raise your hands if you can. If you can separate, you should have about 6 feet of distance if you can. Kind of just spin. Here we go. Just get your energy out. And if you can, let's just open up and let's just give a cry. Let's give a shout. Who's excited to be in church today? Come on, here we go. All right, let's sing.
We will not be moved. You're standing with us. We will not be moved. When everything around is shaking, you're not changing. We will not be. We will not be moved.
Let's sing together.
Where can I go? oceans rage, the mountains shake, but we would trust, trust in your name. We're holding fast to your promises. What you have spoken will surely come to pass. Sing it, we will not be moved. You're standing with us, we will not be moved. When everything around is shaking, you're not changing. We will not be, we will not be moved.
If you're not going to be moved today, give a shout of praise for the Lord. Amen, amen. We're going to keep praising our God, for He is good and greatly to be praised. Are never enough. That's right. So you came along. You put me back together. Now every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Come on, let's tell them how good He is. And there's not a place you're merciful. friends and tell them,
oh, there's nothing better than you.
There's nothing, nothing, Lord.
Better than you.
Oh, there's nothing, Lord.
Nothing is better than you.
Amen. I'm going to share a scripture with you guys. You guys doing all right? Awesome. So it says in the book of Numbers, it says, "The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace." That blessing that the Lord says over the nation of Israel lives in us today through the Spirit of Jesus. Amen. He says in the book of Leviticus, he says, "I will look on you with favor and make you fruitful and increase your numbers, and I will keep my covenant with you." You know, the God of Israel keeps his promises. Amen, church. That's reason to say amen this morning, because I feel like in this year, in this craziness, it's easy to think, man, does God still keep his promises? Does God still honor the covenant that he has with me? And the answer is yes. And that's why we come to worship together, to exalt his name, but also to remind each other that God is good and he's kept his promise with you. You may be going through a mental health crisis right now. You may be facing all sorts of financial troubles, or maybe family issues, or maybe you're just having a tough time raising a kid. Whatever it is, he hasn't forgotten his promise, and we can't forget to praise him. Praise him through the valleys and praise him for his promise. So we're going to teach you a new song today called "The Blessing," and it's straight from scripture. It's just that scripture: "The Lord bless you and keep you. And let's sing this together. I know we're going to learn it, but we're just singing the Bible, y'all. Let's sing this together. Here we go. Just take a deep breath. I want you to ready your mind and your heart to receive this blessing and to say this blessing, to sing it, and to focus on the Lord's blessing and how good He is to you.
May His presence go before you. can go ahead and grab your seat and watch this week's Qdogo video.
I'm Zach Fazio, and today we have some great news from the churches in Indonesia. The church in Jakarta started the year celebrating their 30th anniversary, but by March, the pandemic was already wreaking havoc. The church's welfare committee immediately distributed food relief to members in the congregation facing economic difficulty. Hope Worldwide contributed 2 units of portable sinks for areas in North Jakarta. Disciples joined the Hope Worldwide hashtag Skip a Meal Challenge. They raised almost $15,000 to help those in need. The churches in Indonesia have had an incredibly strong online presence this last year, hosting a wide variety of online events. Their digital Christmas service had 3,400 participants. The church in Indonesia continues to spread the gospel online during this difficult pandemic season. And in 2020, 29 members were restored to the church and 657 people were baptized. Praise God for His work in the churches in Indonesia. Thank you for joining us for this Good News Minute. God bless.
Good morning, good morning, everybody. It's great to see you, and thanks for turning up those lights in the back. That way I can see you a little bit better. I hope that you're having a good day. And again, I want to say, you know, I know we're all, I'm sure, tired of COVID, that's for sure. But I just appreciate everybody wearing a mask so that people that there are some that are more vulnerable in their stage of life, and we just appreciate everybody bending over backwards so that everybody can feel comfortable. And after the service today, we're going to step outside. It's another beautiful San Antonio spring day, and we'll be able to have fellowship. And for those of you that are at home today, we want to say welcome. And if you're visiting with us, we're so glad that you're here. Please go to our website so that you can get connected with our congregation. www.missionpointchristianchurch.com and get connected with our congregation. We're doing all kinds of cool stuff during the week and on the weekends. And we're going to be working now to try to get back to a double service on Sunday, and so that more people can be here in person, because I know we've all noticed that the virus levels are low. We still want to we still want to obey our governing authorities, the health authorities, but keep praying. But we think we can have 2 services and open this back up. And then I want to a little bit keeping it safe. And then I want to say thank you to the technical crew who got up at 5 a.m. in order to come in here and to set up and do all this work for us. They did an outstanding job today. Amen. And also the worship team, who always does an amazing job. Thank you, worship team, just for your hard work, and your joy just comes through. You know, it must have been embarrassing for President Biden. He stumbled on the stairs of the plane the other day, and there's cameras watched, and then they replay it. And they did that to Donald Trump, and they did that to Gerald Ford, and they did it to every president. I mean, you can't walk up the stairs to Air Force One like 500 times during your presidency. You're going to stumble once. And, you know, so you feel for the guy when he stumbles, and then it gets run on TV. And let me see, wasn't it Jennifer Lawrence who stumbled on her way up to accept the Oscar at the Academy Award? And then everybody was like, did she do it on purpose because she wanted to show off her dress and everything? And this big conversation for a while, and stumbling. I've stumbled. Don't you hate it when you stumble? And a friend of mine, Ron Drabo, anytime anybody would stumble, he would then fake a stumble just to make you feel better. I always laughed at that. I thought it was great. Today, what we're going to be talking about is stumbling blocks. And I want to read a passage here in Luke 17, where Jesus, verse 1, where Jesus said to his disciples, things that cause people to stumble are bound to come. But woe to anyone through whom they come. It would be better for them to be thrown into the sea with a millstone tied around their neck than to cause one of these little ones to stumble. So watch yourselves, If your brother or sister sins against you, rebuke them. And if they repent, forgive them. Even if they sin against you 7 times in a day, and 7 times come back to you saying, I repent, you must forgive them. Let's say a prayer here and dive into the Word of God. Holy Father, thank you for your scriptures. Thank you for your Word. And I do pray, Father, that we'll all learn some great lessons today about stumbling blocks. And I pray, Father, that God, that you'll give us deep conviction. Make us men and women of faith and men and women of your Word. In Jesus' name, amen. Funny enough, the word in the Greek text for stumbling block is skandalon. Where we also eventually through the centuries, from Greek and Latin, that became our word scandal. And they're sort of related, but they're, you know, whatever. It's been 1,300 years and anyway. But a skandalon in Greek is that stick that props open the trap. And then the animal goes in and the trap boom, falls down. They called that stick the skandalon. And then also if they would hunt by putting a little string out and leave the string in a circle, and maybe a rabbit would run through the string and get caught in the noose, and then would have to wait there until you come and you check your trap, and okay. And that was first century hunting. But a skandalon was also a stone which we've all kicked as we've walked down a trail, and it makes you stumble because, you know, you got a trail and the stone is just sticking up high enough to catch the toe of your shoe or whatever, and you trip over. It is a skandalon is anything that ensnares, traps, or trips you up, all right? And what Jesus says here is that these things are bound to come. They're bound to come. And he's using legal language here with this phrase, bound to come. It is inconceivable. It is, in fact, inadmissible that scandalon will not come. There's a very strong statement. You will not have a smooth as glass pathway in front of you. There will be bumps along the way. There will be bumps. And it is just a non-starter to think that there will not be stumbling blocks. So stumbling blocks are out there, okay? And that means we want to be ready for stumbling blocks. We want to be ready. We want to be on guard. We're not walking through the mall. We're not walking on a perfect golf green. We're walking on a trail, and there's little stumps, and there's rocks, and there's this, and there's that, and we want to be careful. The path will be difficult, and it's important to know that. That's just the way it is. Now, I don't fall a lot. I have pretty good balance. I grew up, and I seem to gravitate toward balance sports. Although probably basketball is the thing that I played the most of, but I love skiing, ice skating, but more roller skating as a kid, riding bikes, skateboarding. I did all these things. So I have pretty good balance. My wife Ambergeet, who I know is watching this in Dallas, she's visiting her parents. And I love Ambergeet so much, but Ambergeet is so clumsy on her feet. We did a second honeymoon after we were married 5 years, and we went to the Bahamas, and it was really wonderful. The second day that we were there, we were walking through the parking lot of the hotel, and she tripped and she fell in the parking lot, and there was her nice beach T-shirt. There was a black mark on it, and you know whatever from falling, and she cried. You know, she was like, you know, for like, you know, 5 minutes. And we'd been under a lot of pressure in the ministry as a couple there, just dealing with things in a specific church situation, and then she was great for the rest of the trip. But Ambergeet has a plaque on her desk, and that plaque says, "It takes great talent to trip on flat surfaces." And I just think I'm going to come back and brag on my wife in amazing ways, but you know, it's just she can trip, she can fall, so can I. I think my most famous tripping up was we were playing disc golf, and I was about 50 feet away, and instead of throwing it like this, like we usually do, I was going to throw it like this okay? And to make the putt, it's called disc golf with a frisbee golf. So I go like this, and I'm with three other brothers I've known for a long time. And I got it off perfect, and then I felt it. I'm too far out over my toes. And then I hit a stumbling block, and I couldn't quite catch my other foot. And then all of a sudden, as the frisbee went, boom, right into the basket perfectly. It was a beautiful birdie. I was falling down right at that moment. Of course, my old friends, what did they do? I mean, I was just so glad nobody was filming it. Pay attention. Be careful. Watch where you're walking. Who are you listening to? What are you doing? You're not running a race on a smooth track. You're not on a paved surface. Your race is run on a trail. That's why all these mountain bikers have all these broken bone stories to tell you. But traps exist. Rocks are sticking up. It's easy to stumble and fall. And that's a good warning. But Jesus adds another layer. And he says, don't you be the guy causing someone else to stumble. So he brings it up one level. Woe to anyone through whom they come. It would be better for them to be thrown into the sea with a millstone tied around their neck than to cause one of these little ones to stumble. Woe, you are better off with a millstone tied around your neck, thrown into the sea, then you are causing someone else to stumble. Now, we have a picture of a millstone. I think they're going to put it up right now. But the point is, you don't want to be the person who's causing somebody else to stumble. And I don't want to be impacted by that person either. All right? Now, this is a millstone. All right? And this is a, I believe this millstone is in Turkey. And there's thousands of these that archaeologists have dug up. They weigh anywhere from 500 to 3,000 pounds, and I don't know if you can see it or more, but this guy, he's practicing his millstone. They would put the grain in there, and then they would run that huge stone over it, and that's how they would mill their grain so that they could bake their bread. This is a huge stone, as you can see, and there's hundreds of them at archaeological sites. We know exactly what Jesus was talking about when he said, you're better off with a millstone tied around your neck and thrown into the sea than causing other people to stumble. That's how serious Jesus takes it. We don't want to be a bad example. We don't want to be someone that pushes somebody in the wrong direction spiritually, okay? Well, what are things that cause other people to stumble? You know, I think one big thing that causes people to stumble can be our words. Our words cause people to stumble. Sometimes, just being angry. You know, some people just use their anger in a manipulative way to control the situation. They'll get angry and they'll lash out and people will kind of back off. And by just be getting verbally angry and making it louder, they can kind of control the situation. It just ruins relationships. It causes other people to stumble. We want to make sure that we speak to one another with love and kindness. You know, gossip is so damaging. Gossip is so damaging, and it makes other people stumble. Proverbs 18 verse 8 says that gossip goes down like choice morsels. It's kind of fun to listen to gossip. There's a temptation there. And if you're not careful, then you're participating in the gossip yourself. And you've got to be careful. Proverbs 26:20, without gossip, a quarrel dies down. But gossip creates factions. And all of a sudden, I'm talking to you about, have you heard the latest, Esteban, about Hervé? It's just between you and me. And we always have some good reason to gossip, or we act like it. No, I'm not gossiping. I'm just being open, Esteban. Let me tell you about Hervé. No, this isn't gossip. I'm just sharing. I'm just sharing from my heart. Okay, and really, you know, it's gossip. If we've got something to say, we ought to say it to Hervé, all right? Not at this moment, please wait till after the service. But if you've got something to say, say it to him. And don't be a coward, because anybody can go around and talk about people. They don't hand out medals for that. But a man, a woman of moral fiber will go directly to the person and say, hey, we need to talk. Does that make sense? I really appreciate Tammy Fleming. She'll stop people in mid-sentence. All right? She'll stop him in mid-sentence. She's somebody that has impressed me always. Wait. Have you talked to this person? Oh, no, then I don't think I should be hearing this story. Can I give you their phone number so that you can talk to the correct person? And I think that's great. I think that's so great. Because without gossip, a quarrel dies down. So we want to be righteous and not be a stumbling block. Because when I start gossiping to Esteban about Hervé, when I start doing that, then Esteban is like, well, and then he now is stumbling by listening. He stumbles by listening, okay? And so that's what, we just don't want that. Tempting someone when they're weak, obviously, that's a stumbling block. Are you in a romantic relationship? Then you want to lead your special someone toward Jesus. And don't tempt them to go past their boundaries. Don't tempt them to step beyond their convictions. We want to lead one another always toward Jesus. Amen to that? Jesus repeatedly warned us about false teachers. False teachers create stumbling blocks. And so we are warned about that. They promise easier paths. False prophets, they behave like Satan did in the garden, lying like he did in the garden. Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? And that's actually not what God said. He kind of changed the verse around. You will not certainly die, he told Eve, and she did because she went along with it. But this is what false prophets do. They try to, oh, come on, really? I mean, did God really mean that? Did God really mean that? You know, when I was in my 20s, you know, it was God designed marriage for a man and a woman, and then you get married, and there's this beautiful physical relationship that happens inside of marriage, and it's a beautiful thing, and it's a wonderful thing. And I know for me, though, when I was in my, when I was studying the Bible, I'm like, oh, wow. I mean, I have been living so opposed to the moral ethic of the scriptures. I've just been so opposed to this. One night I even cried. I wondered, I'm not even sure that I can change all these sins and go in the right direction. And God helped me to change. But in every generation, there are people who are going to attack what the scriptures teach about something. And they're going to say, ah, yes, and perhaps they'll try to twist scripture like Satan does, masquerading as an angel of light. Or they're going to try it just doesn't matter. And it does. When somebody says, oh, come on, sleep with whoever you want, that is false teaching. It is a stumbling block. Avoid it. Oh, come on, tell me it's okay to gossip. It's okay. No, it's not. And as disciples, we make a decision that I'm going to live as Jesus wants me to live. False teachers are like stones sticking up in the path. You know, I love, you guys with me on this? Amen. I love our country. Our country is a free country, and we are a consumer society. We have the right to pursue happiness here. It's a beautiful thing what we have in America. And in society, we live in a society where it's often all about me or you. Okay? And I remember when I was a kid, Burger King had this ad, and it was, hold the pickles, hold the lettuce, special orders, don't upset us. All we ask is that you let us have it your way. It's your way. I can still sing the song, hold the pickle, hold the lettuce, special orders, don't. Okay, I'm just having fun up here. Because it's a consumer society. It's all about me. I go to Burger King. It's all about me. How do you want that? I want it this way. And sometimes we go to church. And then we go, this is how I want it. And we think church is like a cafeteria. Yes, I'd like some hugs, yes. Music? Oh, yeah, no, the music is good. Conviction about gossip? No, thank you. No, thank you. I'm not going to put that on my tray. Conviction about stumbling blocks. Maybe just a little. I mean, can I agree with it but not eat it? I'll just put it on my tray, you know, like this. And we go through like church is a cafeteria, and church isn't a cafeteria. you know, I love our free country, but in the kingdom of God, in Christ Jesus, we make a decision to deny ourselves.
Amen. Come on.
And so there's a lot of things where like, man, I really feel like doing this. Well, we don't do it because why? Because Jesus is Lord.
That's right.
And I've always found out in my life that when I do follow what Jesus said to do, that I'm actually happier.
Always.
That I'm happier when I follow what Jesus says to do. So for those who stumble, that's serious. And for those who cause others to stumble, that's really serious. And then in Matthew 13, it gets really serious. When Jesus talks about people that are causing others to stumble, in verse 40, Jesus is in Matthew 13, verse 40, and Jesus summing up this parable about how in God's kingdom that Satan sowed weeds, people in the kingdom, and he says in verse 40, as the weeds are pulled up and burned in the fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send out his angels, and they will weed out of his kingdom everything that causes sin, scandalon, and all who do evil. They will throw them into the blazing furnace, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Whoever has ears, let them hear. Wow, this is a very heavy scripture. What's going to happen at Judgment Day is that actually the Son of Man's going to send out his angels and weed out of his kingdom everything that causes sin or causes people to sin. What do you mean, weed out of his kingdom? That means sometimes people sneak in and they're in church and they're actually causing other people to sin. And Jesus says, you cannot hide in the Lord's church. And on the day, you may fool people, but you won't fool Jesus. And so when we're causing other people to sin here, then Jesus says, oh, no, no, there's gonna, the gig's up here on Judgment Day. And he says there will be weeping and there will be gnashing of teeth. Weeping signifying sadness, gnashing of teeth signifying anger. Because some people will just be ticked off that they're not Lord, and they'll be ticked off about it, and they'll be gnashing their teeth in hell. That's a heavy thought. Wolves usually dress like sheep when they tempt and teach falsehood. So the last thing you want to be is a stumbling block. Amen?
Amen.
Don't be like Peter. When Jesus turned to Peter in Matthew 16, and Jesus turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. Poor Peter. You know, we read about Peter's mistakes and, you know, he had just done so well. In identifying Jesus as the Son of the living God. He'd just done so well. And then Jesus says, I'm going to go to Jerusalem. I'm going to be crucified. And on the third day, I'm going to be raised to life. And Peter says, no, that's never going to happen to you. No way. He argues. He actually rebukes Jesus. And Jesus says, get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns. Jesus gave a stinging rebuke to Peter for being a stumbling block. And you know, that's why we just need to be on guard for stumbling blocks. So that when somebody says, hey, let me give you a juicy morsel here of gossip, we go, whoa, 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 whoa. You know, the right way to settle this is bup, bup, bup. And we take a stand that we go, whoa, 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 hang on, guy. You know what? I'm not sure we should actually be right here. Maybe this isn't a good place for me as a believer. Or, you know what? I hear something said doctrinally or doctrinally, however you pronounce that word. You know what? I think I need to go study this out because I want to be a Berean. I want to be somebody who hears it. And the Bereans were noble because even the Apostle Paul, they went back and they read and made sure that what the apostles said was true and that was a noble thing that they did. That's good. That's a great habit to have. I heard what this person said. Now let me go back to the scriptures and let me check this out and make sure it's right. Amen?
Amen.
You know, that's just good. That's just good. And to be a Berean. And so the point I'm making here is very simple. Don't be a stumbling block. Rather, and now I'm going to confuse you. I hope not. But in a different way, be a stumbling block. In Romans chapter 9, verse 33, because Jesus was a stumbling block, it says in Romans 9, 33, they stumbled over the stumbling stone. It is written, see, I lay in Zion a stone that causes people to stumble and a rock that makes them fall. And the one who believes in him will never be put to shame. What's the point of the passage? Is that here comes the Messiah. And he's like a stone, but he caused some people to stumble because they would not accept the truth. Because Jesus was strong. He stood for what was right. And some people tripped on that. They couldn't wrap their brain around it. It was a rock that makes them fall. And the one who believes in him will never be put to shame. So now what we're seeing is, now Paul in Romans chapter 9 is using the word stumbling block now in a positive sense to communicate the idea that we sang in that first song. Thank you very much for leading that first song, that we shall not be moved. That we won't be moved. Because you know when you kick a rock in the and it won't be moved? That's what we should be like in Jesus. Isaiah prophesied that the Messiah would be the cornerstone. And Jesus is described as the living stone, the stone the builders rejected, the cornerstone, the capstone, and even the stumbling stone. And I know I've tripped over that stone. I tripped over that stone as I grappled with it to follow Jesus Christ. But Jesus is that immovable rock in the ground that we kick. And what we want to do is humble out before him. He did not budge. He did not waver. He did not compromise. So people stumbled, but they also considered their lives. And so many came back and repented. And that's what I want to be. I want to be immovable, like we sang about. I want to be like Jesus, who has deep conviction and doesn't rise and fall with whatever is popular in this particular decade. But who lives out the faith that Jesus called us to live and lives it out with courage. Okay? I don't want to be like a golf ball that when the golfer hits it, there it goes. I want to be like the tree so that when the golfer hits it, the club comes to a stop. I want to be immovable like that. Amen? Amen. And that's why I fell in love with Amber Jeet, because she's an absolute stumbling block for the Lord in the good sense of the word. She loved, when I met her, I thought, this woman is amazing. She loved God. She was immovable. It was fantastic. The more I got to know her, the more that I loved her. She's just, to me, she's always been in her entire life someone devoted to God, devoted to Jesus. And in that way, she was like a stumbling block that you run into. And it was like, oh man, this woman's the real deal. I think about Sam Powell in New York, and the New York church was in trouble in 2003, and there was a lot of complaining at that point in the church, and Sam Powell just impressed me so much. He rose up and just led. He stood for scripture. He listened like amazingly. He stood up for what was right. He stood up for truth, but he also gave people time to really talk, whatever, and it put him in the hospital at one point, but he stood strong for what was right. He was like Jesus, that stumbling stone. He would not be moved from Scripture. And I just think that's great. And perhaps, to me, the one that is so obvious as a stumbling block, who would not be moved, on December 1st, 1955, Rosa Parks boarded the Cleveland Avenue bus in downtown Montgomery, Alabama. Three stops later, when the bus driver ordered her to give up her seat for a white man, the 42-year-old seamstress would not be moved. I thought of Emmett Till, a young man who had been lynched recently, and I couldn't move, she'd say later. When the driver threatened to have her arrested, Parks answered, "You may do that." Parks was hailed as the mother of the civil rights movement when she died in 2005, and she became the first woman to lie in state in the Capitol Rotunda. She would not be moved. What a beautiful example for every man and woman in this auditorium today. But of course, the perfect example is Jesus Christ. Let us imitate his conviction, his strength. Let us never be a stumbling block to anyone else. Let everything that ever comes out of our mouth be for building others up. And in the same way, let us be a stumbling block in Romans 9, that we are firmly rooted and immovable, like we sang about in that first song. We want to be that kind of strong and convicted for Jesus, that kind of standing firm for the Messiah. I hope today has encouraged you. God bless.
Awesome. First of all, can we just say thank you to Mike? That was a fantastic sermon. Thank you so much for your words. And it's great to be together in person. A special shout out to the YoPro. It's great to see you guys and, of course, everyone else as well. But Mike, thank you so much for your sermon. I think personally for me, the thing that really stood out to me, especially with the scriptures that you highlighted, is Jesus' conviction that he was just unwilling to waver. And it's such an honor as his disciple to follow in his example. Thank you for pointing that out.
Amen. Yes, Mike, thank you so much. I feel so convicted by this sermon today. I love the call to value God's word, value the community, rather than just having it our way. And can I just say, it's always a special treat when we get a Mike song.
Yes.
And a sermon on Sundays. Those are always my favorite sermons. So thank you, Mike, so much. It was very challenging.
Amen. At this time, we're going to transition into contribution, and Hannah's going to read a scripture to prepare our hearts.
Colossians 3, verses 1 through 4 says, "Since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory."
Amen. I love the scripture so much because Paul teaches that there's a clear distinction in the way that we used to live before we followed Jesus and the way that we live now as disciples. Since we have been raised, past tense, we now live a new life. And he calls us to do this by setting our hearts and our minds on things above. And of course, there's a lot of ways that we can do that. Having our quiet times daily and going to church and fellowship. But certainly one of those ways that we can set our hearts and minds on things above is through our contribution and our money. So at this time, if you want to give, you are able to go to the Mission Point website. That's missionpointcc.com. There will be a countdown here in just a moment. But I'm going to go ahead and say a word of prayer as we set our hearts and minds on things above through our finances. Bow with me. God, thank you so much for this opportunity to come together to worship you, God. You are such a good God, Father, and you are worthy of all of our praise, all of our worship, and worthy of our contribution, God. I pray that we would set our hearts and our minds on things above in every aspect of our life, but certainly also in our finances, God. We love you and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Stay tuned as Mike will be sharing some announcements in just a moment. Awesome. We've had a fantastic service. I have a couple of very cool announcements. One is for the youth and family. So coming up on April 10th, we're going to have a joint prom with the Austin Teen Ministry. And so make sure to sign up for that. We're asking that everybody go online and sign up. You can look at the GroupMe for the website to sign up there. But we're asking everyone that if you're going to go, please register by March 25th. So that's this week. Please make sure that you register for that. The prom is April 10th from 6 to 10 p.m. in Driftwood, Texas. It's going to be a fantastic, fantastic time. And then the other thing is we want to invite all the high school seniors to come and join us this next weekend for our campus retreat. It's going to be a fantastic time. We put the itinerary on the group. On the GroupMe. So seniors, we know that you're coming onto campus here soon. We want to invite you guys, please come along. And if you're a campus student, make sure you register, and the high school seniors, make sure you register. It's $19 at the Mission Point website. Just put in the tab for Mission Point Church in the memo section right there. It's going to be a great time. We'll see everybody next Friday night up in New Braunfels as we kick that off. Thanks.
Thank you. Next Sunday, we'll be back. We're going to work on trying to expand to two services, and we'll get the information out to you really quickly through the email. But definitely, we will be here with a live stream service at 10:30. We want to invite everybody to come on back, and please be inviting others just by sending our the link for the Mission Point Christian Church YouTube channel. You can use that to invite people to come to church every Sunday, and we'll be back right here next Sunday at 10:30, and that's going to be a special campus Sunday, I believe, is it not? Next Sunday is the campus retreat next Sunday, and so that'll be a special service next Sunday for the campus, but we'll all be able to participate and to watch via live stream. But we're also, it was great today to have a watch party in the other ballroom, so the UTSA students, all the San Antonio campus students were watching in there. That's exciting. We want to use every possible opportunity to come together and have safe fellowship. Amen to that. So at this time, we're going to wrap up our church service again, if you're visiting with us, please check out our website, missionpointchristianchurch.com, and get connected with our congregation. We look forward to seeing you here on a socially distanced Sunday as soon as possible, or at one of the communion, Zoom, little communion services, or many things, so many things that we do. We look forward to meeting you, and we hope we can very soon. For those of us here in the auditorium, we're gonna exit from the back here, and we'll take our fellowship outside, and it has been tremendous to be together. Let me say a quick prayer, and we'll close out. Holy Father, thank you. We love you. Help us, Father, to not be moved by stumbling blocks that come into our lives, but help us to imitate the cornerstone, the capstone, the living stone, the stumbling stone, the immovability of Jesus Christ. Help us to put that into practice this week. We love you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. 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 You are dismissed, and let's hang around outside. It's a beautiful day for fellowship.